Good evening. My name is Denise Davis. I was raised in a Catholic family. Actually, it was an Italian Catholic family. By that I mean you were born Catholic. There was no choice. We attended church regularly and even had mass. We attended church regularly, even had a particular mass, a particular pew, that we would walk into one by one every Sunday like clockwork. We prayed every meal, but it was the same prayer, no changes, no additions. Every day prior to school, we were required to attend Mass, and on Saturdays we were to go to confession, to confess our sins, to be cleansed of them for the week. Daily I attended a religion class. I have to confess, I excelled in that class. I loved reading about the stories. I was a very active young girl. I loved sports. I loved being outside. But above everything else, I loved my father. He was my everything. I have memories of being a toddler in a shopping cart with him pushing me with my arms wrapped tightly around him. I had been born with a congenital cataract and was blind in my left eye. My father drove me all over the Midwest states to different specialists to try to find someone who could give sight to that otherwise blind eye. My father, at one point, tried to give me his eye as a transplant, but it was something that, it was a procedure that was just entirely too new and they couldn't do anything with that. He taught me that there was nothing that I couldn't do if I didn't just try. Then on November 2nd, 1970, the unthinkable happened. My father died and everything was shattered. I was 13 years old and I was broken. Why would God take him from me? He was a good man. He suffered here on earth, and I couldn't understand why God would do that to me. Why would he take the one person that I could count on? There were so many questions. My mother was also struggling, and I found myself in the role of being caretaker for her. I threw myself into the day-to-day responsibilities of cooking and cleaning. I was really frustrated, I was confused, and I was really alone. At the age of 16, I left home. And I lived alone for some time, but I eventually married a guy. I thought he was the answer to the prayers of a lonely girl. But instead, after moving away from everyone I knew, his several affairs and verbal and physical abuse, I found myself with one child, awaiting the birth of my second child, and more alone than ever. I remember asking God to help me as I booked our flight home. Life was tough, but we had each other. My mother and I had begun to forge a great friendship. We were never good at being mother and daughter, but we had begun to be great at being friends. I continued to have random conversations with God, and I say random because as I look back, these conversations were only when I needed something or when I felt the most alone. I still had so many questions, and because of it, I rarely attended Mass. I convinced myself that if God was this loving, caring God, he didn't care if I went to church on Sunday. That just sounded ridiculous to me. A friend of mine decided to set me up on a blind date. I was really reluctant. Turned out the man was really reluctant as well. You can imagine that. He had been through a difficult time too, and wasn't all that excited to put himself out there either. Then as I discovered more about this man, I realized that I knew him. Not only did I know him, but he was the first boy that I had ever kissed. He had always had a special place in my heart. So done, I was going. And he felt the same, good thing. Our journey began on that date, and he has been a blessing from God ever since. Michael adopted my two children. He had one, and we had one together. We have a beautiful family, another blessing from God. Michael had also been raised Catholic, and this created some issues with us. We agreed that we needed the Lord in our life, but we couldn't agree on what that meant for our family. He clung onto what he knew, but I felt that my church had let me down. We tried going to church many times, but it always left me angry. That went on for many years, and during those years, my mother was diagnosed with lymphoma, and she eventually died. A while later, my father-in-law was diagnosed with leukemia, and he eventually died. I was able to care for both of them during those times, and I know that they both believed in God. They were both steady churchgoers, but I don't know for certain of either one of their salvation. We eventually moved to Ankeny, and we needed to connect with God, so I agreed to go to church again, but as always, after several attempts, it just left me feeling like it wasn't the answer. What are we going to do? My conversations with God were still so random, and yet it felt better than just those standard prayers that I learned as I was growing up as a child. A visitor came to our door one day. His name was Chuck, and he was from Sailorville. He happened to be from Wisconsin, and he was a Packer fan. Imagine that. That really worked well with us. There was something about this guy that both Michael and I agreed that we immediately liked him. He came back on a couple occasions, and we got to talking, and we touched on the subject of faith. Michael and Chuck spent quite a lot of time talking, and they decided that they were going to work on some studies. That was my cue to back out. Michael and I had spent so many years agreeing to disagree on the subject of faith that I wasn't going to be anywhere near that. So Michael and Chuck started their studies. But I could see that Michael was really enjoying this, that he was changing, that he was softening. And I wanted some of that. But how could I? Because every time Chuck would come over, I would say hello and graciously walk out of the room and let them go on with their studies. Then one day, Chuck came over just randomly. Wasn't his typical day. And we were talking, and he looked at me and he said, "Would you like to do the studies?" I thought my heart was going to miss a beat. Yes, I would. So he and Michael both talked, and they said, "Well, let's start them over." So they did, and I started the studies with them. For the first time in my life, I actually opened a Bible and began to read scripture. It was exciting. It was overwhelming at times. In October of 2011, one evening we were going over our second studies. It was about the fact that we cannot gain salvation through human merit. We were discussing the fact that salvation is gained by putting our faith on the cross. The fact that Jesus died on the cross to bear the burden of our sin, and as far as what we do nothing. We're sinners, and all I'm asked to do is admit that I'm a sinner and trust in Jesus Christ. Romans 10:13, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." I was overcome with emotion that day. I felt like I'd finally found what I was searching for. I was accepted in spite of myself. God loves me so much that he gave his only son to save me. That evening after Chuck left, I was getting ready for bed, and I had a conversation with God. But for the first time, it wasn't a random conversation. It wasn't because I needed anything. It was because I admitted to him that I was a sinner and that I wanted to put my trust in the cross and Christ for my salvation, and to thank him for never giving up on me all those years that I prayed only for what he could do for me. He had blessed me even though I was too blind to see. He had never abandoned me. In Hebrews 13:5, "I will never leave you, never forsake you." In December 2011, after 50-plus years of hearing the same thing every time I went for my eye examination, I found myself in unfamiliar territory. There was a surgery that they could do to remove my congenital cataract, quite possibly to give sight to an otherwise blind eye. Praise the Lord, because now, months later, after that surgery and some slight difficulties, I find myself no longer blind. Truly a miracle. I am so blessed to have such a loving God. God always kept nudging me and prodding me along the way, making sure that I never strayed too far. I always felt his presence in my darkest hour, but I could never explain him. I am a sinner. I'm not perfect, but the Lord understands. Hebrews 4:15 through 16, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet not a sinner, not without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive and find grace to help in time of need. I feel like I'm home and I'm safe. I look at life differently now, and I praise the Lord for each and every moment and every blessing. He has given me so much to be grateful for. My biggest regret is that in my searching, my children are still lost. I hope to share with my children, with my family, and anyone who will listen, so that they too will have salvation and share in God's kingdom. I am a mere toddler in his word, but I plan to take every moment of my time here on earth to continue in his word and to show my gratitude to him. I am a soldier of God, and I will live this life for him.
Hi, good evening, ladies. My name is Allie Johnson. My husband is Thaddeus, or Pookie, as many of you may know him. We have been coming to Sailorville for almost a year, and I just want to say it has been life-changing to have Pastor Pat and Marilyn and many of you in our lives and supporting us and encouraging us. We're just so grateful. Before knowing Christ and before having a personal relationship with him, I was a religious person. I was a good person, but I had a misunderstanding of the law. I was legalistic, and I'm here to share my story. My home growing up was full of life, love, energy, and fun. I have parents who love me, they support me, they care for me, and I wouldn't change it for the world. But God was not a part of our lives. I grew up going to church. I was baptized. I did communion. But church to my family was something that we did on Sundays. I don't really remember praying or talking about God at home. And then we got busy in high school with sports and dance. We became holiday churchgoers, and then we eventually just stopped going. In college, I definitely lived up the college lifestyle. I got caught up in my own selfish ways. I did find myself thinking more and more about God, but I never took the initiative to go to church by myself or to find out the answers to all the questions I was having. And then my sophomore year, I met my husband, Pookie, and the first week we were together was so bizarre because it was like we knew we were going to be together from day one. We were immediately discussing all the important issues, like how we wanted to live our lives. And my husband grew up knowing God, knowing about God, and knowing that he wanted to live a Christian life. But at that time, their beliefs revolved more so around legalism, a works religion, rather than focusing on the grace of God. So my mind went from being curious about God and kind of wanting to know a little bit more to being shocked and thinking, how am I ever going to live my life that way or do all these things in order to be saved? And then a little while into our relationship, we started going to Bible study with his parents, Candy and Stephen, and we loved it. We felt good about it. We gave our emotional testimonies at the end of every lesson. But I realized now that I was living a legalistic life. I was following certain rules, and I was fearing God, but not loving God. And, I felt good about going to church. I truly felt that by reading my Bible, by keeping the Sabbath, by being a good person, I thought that I was gaining favor with God. But it was a checklist for me. It wasn't anything personal. And then we got engaged, we got married, and we moved to a new city. We bought a house, we bought new cars, we took vacations, we got a dog. I was doing all these great things with a wonderful man and doing all these worldly things that should make us happy. My husband is my best friend, and we've been so blessed in the first 3 years of our marriage. But something was missing. There was a reason why we were never fully satisfied. It's because we were missing Jesus. And then one day at church, Stephen and Candy said to me that Jesus knows what's in your heart. And almost immediately, my life changed. I started thinking, if Jesus truly knows what's in my heart, why am I satisfied with my shallow and superficial faith? By this time, I had been listening to Christian music, and I found many songs that spoke to my heart. I found myself asking God just to open my heart and to lead me on the path that He chose for my life. And then out of the blue, in August of 2011, my father-in-law, Stephen, was diagnosed with cancer. And that just hit our family like a ton of bricks. It was on a Friday, and at church the next day, the first words out of his mouth was, "Let this be to the glory of God." And that just truly impacted me. I thought, how can someone who just got the worst news be thinking, "Glory to God"? And I thought, wow, I want that kind of faith. I need that kind of faith. And just 3 short months later, Stephen was gone. And looking back, God began to change my heart that day. And God truly works in amazing ways, because I would have never have thought that Stephen, the man whose faith inspired me the most, would be taken away from us in order for me to find God and to become closer to Him. And then last December, we came to Sailorville, where we heard Pastor Pat preach the gospel over and over, that Christ died for our sins, for my sin, and was buried and rose again to grant us eternal life. And that personalized it for me. A life-changing verse for me has been Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. "For by grace you have been saved through faith, not that of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone may boast." Period. Not that being a good person will save us, not that good works will save us, and surely not that we can save ourselves. So on January 17th, 2012, in our living room, on my knees with my husband by my side, I repented of my sins and placed my faith in Jesus Christ as my Savior. And since then, I can feel God in my life every single day. I would like to share with you all a little bit about how God has been working in my life so far. Back in college, when my husband first started explaining all the things I needed to do, or all these things I needed to give up in order to be saved, my mind was shocked. And then I started thinking, wait, I'm not ready yet. I need to clean my life up a little bit, or get my life together beforehand. I now know that it is only Christ that changes you. Accept Him now and cling to His light. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come." Before I knew Christ, it was easy for me to believe that I had to earn my salvation. Now, legalism is a belief that good works will get you to heaven, that you yourself actually earn your way to heaven. Good works can be described as an outward act of service or duty, or something done in order to impress God or to impress others, but not done with a genuine heart. And Jesus knows what's in your heart. He knows the motives behind your actions. He knows the intentions of your heart. And good works without glorifying God are just self-righteous and self-satisfying. It is important to note the difference between legalism and obedience. Obedience to God should come out of our love, our gratefulness, and our commitment to glorify God. The law is still a teacher, though Christ alone is the Savior. Another way to explain legalism is the neglecting of God's grace. And grace is commonly defined as God's unmerited and undeserved favor towards us as sinners. St. Augustine said, "For grace is not given because we have done good works, but in order that we may be able to do them." Galatians 2:16 says, "Knowing that a man is not justified by works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ." And Galatians 2:21 goes on to say that, "I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain." And when I think of literally neglecting God's grace, I think of Romans 5:10 that says, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son." By neglecting God's grace and by not being in Christ, we are considered enemies of God. I realize now that when I was trying to work my way into God's favor, when my heart wasn't in it, I was an enemy. When we work for God without worshiping God, we're magnifying our own power and not giving God the glory. In the beginning, another thing that was difficult for me was to recognize and accept that I am a sinner. I thought, well, I'm a relatively good person. I have my bad days and my selfish moments, but overall, I can't be that bad. Well, God clears this right up in Romans 3:23 that says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Jesus is the only one who will ever live a perfect life, and that is why we need to place our faith in him so that his righteousness will be given to us. Jesus took all of our sins, past, present, future sins, once for all on the cross. And 2 Corinthians 5:21 explains that Jesus was made to be sin for our sake, so that when we believe in him, we might become the righteousness of God. And Jesus is continually seeking out his people. Luke 19:10 states that the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. I urge you to listen when you feel Jesus pulling at your heart. He delights in giving grace. Zephaniah 3:17 says, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness, and he will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing." I accepted Christ into my life 11 months ago, and as I've been digging deeper into his truths, I have recognized a change in myself. I have peace. Romans 5:1 says, "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Is something missing from your life, as was mine? Are you longing for that peace? God wants each of us to have that peace. Accept Christ and let Jesus into your hearts tonight, and he will amaze you with his grace. His wonderful, undeserving, life-changing grace.
We could not pay, but God displayed his mercy, the greatest gift of love. When we could not reach heaven, heaven came to us. He made a way in a manger, a way through the sun. His make a way to the cross. In Bethlehem, the stable became a throne of grace.
Thanks so much for coming out tonight, ladies, and enjoying this year's Rejoice. Sort of a theme of, obviously, Christmas and what comes to your mind when it comes to Christmas time. And I thought about my own personal childhood. My childhood was filled with anticipation. I have no regrets of my child. I was one out of nine kids. I was number eight out of nine. And so my whole early years were just filled with toys. There was more wrapping than there was toys. I mean, we just everywhere. But anticipation is the word that comes to my mind when I think of Christmas growing up as a little boy. It was really the anticipation of Santa. It was all about Santa. Everything was about Santa. And not just during Christmas week. I can still remember my brothers and sisters would threaten me that Santa was watching. It was all behavior modification through Santa watching me. I can remember one time my brother, unbeknownst to us, was up in the attic, which was right above my little brother and I's bed, and he would be shaking some sleigh bells. And my sister would go, "It's Santa Claus," and we'd be pressing up against the screen. This is in the middle of July. And we're looking up there for, you know, Rudolph and company, and sure enough, they would throw a bell down in the garden. So the next morning, we'd find the bell, and we'd think, "Oh my goodness, he was right above us last night." This is the way it went every year. And my kids, getting a little older, 16, 17 years old, people are telling me, "Santa doesn't really exist." Okay, I wasn't that old, really. But I can remember my friend saying it didn't exist. I just absolutely went into denial. I just absolutely refused to believe he didn't exist. And I can still remember being up in that very attic, just rummaging around and playing one afternoon. And it was during the Christmas time. And I opened up this little bin, and there were all these toys. And I just stared. I was devastated because I knew those are the toys I'm going to see here in a couple of weeks. I mean, this is crazy. Every Christmas Eve, we would go out and we would drive around and see the lights. And it just so happened that Santa would always come during that time. I can still remember pulling up once, and I think it was my brother dressed up as Santa jumping over the rail right outside the house. And it's like, we just missed him. Why do we go look at lights? Why do we look at lights? This happened all the time. This is very psychologically damaging to me. And so I find these toys, and sure enough, a couple weeks later, all those toys showed up. And, you know, they're all from Santa. And I just sort of went through the motions that Christmas. I still got the toys, but it wasn't the same. And like I said, I was just sort of going through the motions. Some of you ladies here tonight, you've heard these stories. You've heard the songs of the season sung. But like me on that Christmas when I knew Santa didn't really exist, you're just going through the motions, and you know it. You're going through Christmas without Christ. Christmas without Jesus. When I was a little boy, we did have a religious tradition that was sort of special to us. We had the nativity scene. We always put it underneath the tree. That's where ours went. And we always kept the baby Jesus out. Did anybody ever do that? You kept the baby Jesus out until Christmas Eve. Then you put the baby Jesus in there. Baby Jesus, not there till Christmas Eve. It wasn't the same as Santa, but it was a pretty cool thing. And then on Christmas Eve, we put the baby Jesus into the nativity scene. The truth is, that's the way some of your hearts are tonight. You're a nativity scene at Christmas time without Jesus. You want me to give you something to anticipate? Here's how the Apostle Paul put it. He said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. The word hope there literally means anticipation. Wouldn't it be nice to know that Christ is truly in you? Not just with you, not just around you, not just about the season, but in you. If you listened carefully to Denise and to Allie's stories, some of you are probably like them. You're religious. You've had Christ around you. But he's not in you. You're an empty nativity scene in your heart. There's the hope. There's the anticipation of glory. And someday we will all stand before the living God. And if Christ is in you, that's your hope. That's your anticipation. That's your righteousness. That's your standing before a holy God who sent his son in this season to become the Savior. Behold, born to you this day in the city of David, a Savior who is Christ the Lord, who can be Christ in you. If he's not in you, why don't you invite him in to your manger, so to speak, tonight, so that you can truly enjoy this Christmas season, not with Christ all around you, but with Christ what? In you. What an anticipation. Will you pray with me? Let's pray together. Father, thank you so very much tonight that we can be women, for the most part here, of anticipation of Christ not just with us, not just around us, but within us. The very hope, the very anticipation of glory. I pray for those girls who are here, these women here tonight, Lord, who do not know Christ. And if that's you, we're praying right now. You're just in a spirit of prayer, and you would say, that's me. I'm an empty manger. I don't want this anymore. I don't want to trust my own righteousness. I don't want to trust my religion. I don't want to trust my church. I don't want to trust the good things I've done. I want to trust Jesus. I want to invite him into my heart. And Lord Jesus, would you come into my manger, into my heart? Forgive me of my sins. Clothe me with your righteousness. I believe you died for me and rose again. I'm asking you to come into me that I might have hope, that I might anticipate glory. We pray these things and in this season, dear Lord, in the name of your wonderful Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Merry Christmas to all of you ladies. I hope you have a wonderful Christmas and a truly Christ-filled Christmas. If, perchance, you made that decision tonight from your heart to trust Jesus as your Savior, would you let somebody know about that? You were probably invited by somebody. Just let them know. We want to encourage you. We want to just fill your life with truth if indeed Christ has come to fill your heart. So God bless you and have a very, very Merry Christmas.